Alright, in this short video, I am going to go over the limit, superior, definition, and limit, inferior. And the purpose of this is just to do a little bit better job, I think, of explaining the concept and how it relates to our subsequences. So what we start off doing is we're going to consider a bounded but divergent sequence x equals x sub n. We sometimes need to know the smallest and largest limits that a subsequence can have. Okay, so the way that we do that is we talk about this thing called the limit superior and the limit inferior. So I'm going to give you an alternate definition to what was provided in the text. We're going to let x be a sequence, x sub n, that is bounded. Okay, in fact, I'm going to just specifically say this one is just bounded above, because above is all I need in order to define the limit superior. Now let capital M sub n is going to be a real number, and it is going to be the supremum of everything from the nth term on. That's an n there, and that's not a plus, that's a comma, dot dot dot, okay? So the point here is that M now is going to be the supremum of a tail. This is actually the n minus 1 tail, the way we defined tails in an earlier section. And what we do is we let the limit superior of x sub n be given by the limit, in fact, I'm going to write it this way. Lim sup is the new notation I'm going to use. Lim space sup of x sub n is the limit of these m sub n's. Okay, what happens to the supremum as you look at each progressive tail? Okay, and similarly, we can do the same thing for a limit inferior. So let x equal x sub n be a sequence bounded below, and we'll use a little m sub n to be the infimum of that tail in xn plus 1, xn plus 2, and so on. Okay, then the limit inferior of the sequence is given by lim inf of x sub n is the notation I use, and that's again the limit now of little m sub n. So let's look at a couple of examples. All right, let's consider this sequence here that is x equals negative 1 to the nth. Okay, or the sequence negative 1, 1, negative 1, 1, negative 1, 1, which we know easily diverges. And why it diverges, because we have two subsequences converging to different limits. But in the context of what is a lim sup and a lim inf, well, think of what happens as you start to pay attention only to the tail of that sequence. So lim sup of x sub n, in this case, as I progressively chop off different initial terms, like if I were to look at the entire sequence from this point forward, then the entire sequence from this point forward, right? And the entire sequence from this point forward. Now what you end up seeing is that the m sub n sequence becomes, what is the sup or the supremum of every element of that sequence? Well, the highest it ever is 1, right? And then if I get rid of that and look at just from this point forward, what is the supremum of all the elements that are left to the right of that bracket? It's a 1. And so on. right? Then if I cut it off here, and you'll notice that the supremum is always 1 in this case. Thus, your lim sup is the limit of your m sub n's, which in this case turns out to be 1. And similarly, scroll up a little bit, your lim nth of x sub n is going to be what we'd get when we do a little m sub n, which is the infimum of each successive tail. So if you start here, this infimum, the lowest that can ever be is negative 1. And you see the same thing happen as you begin to chop off the initial terms and look just the tail. The infimum of the terms to the right stay negative 1, which means your infimum is going to be negative 1. That's your lim nth and your lim sup right there. All right, let's do another example. I'm going to consider this sequence here. We've got the first term is 4, the next term is 3.1, the next term is 5.9, then 3.01, and 5.99, 3.001, 5.999, and so on. I think you can see the pattern at that point. So what would be the lim sup of this sequence? Well, as you look at the terms from the left to right, look at the set of terms to the right of that bracket. What is the infimum? No, what is the supremum of that set? You've got numbers going down, but what's the biggest it could possibly be? It's never going to pass. What is the least upper bound for that set? And it's 6. And even if I start cutting off these pieces and look at, well, let's look at from this point forward. The supremum or least upper bound of that set is going to be 6. And that is the lim sup then of the sequence. The lim nth, same thing, except that we now look at the infimum of those progressive tails, which turns out to be 3. Okay? Now there's some interesting and nice results that I'm not going to prove in this little short video. I just want to point them out to you so you can understand how these things relate to the subsequences that we've been talking about. So, theorem, first one. A bounded sequence x equals x sub n converges to x if and only if the lim sup of x sub n is equal to the lim int of x sub n is equal to that x. So notice how this theorem goes both ways. If a sequence converges, then the lim sup and the lim inf are the limit. However, if you know that the lim sup and the lim inf are the same thing, that implies that the sequence itself converges. So you now have an equivalent statement between these two properties of a sequence. Another result that follows is that there is an ordering of these lim sups and lim nths. In fact, let's think of it in terms of subsequences. If x sub n sub k is a subsequence to a bounded sequence x sub n, and I'm choosing bounded so that we know that the lim sup and the lim nth actually exist, then the lim nth of the original sequence is always going to be less than or equal to the lim nth of any subsequence. And the lim nth is always less than or equal to the lim sup. So the lim nth of the subsequence is less than or equal to the lim sup of the subsequence, which is also then less than or equal to the lim sup of the entire sequence. Now really where we get the most use or mileage out of the concept of the lim sup has to do with how it relates to what I called in class the subsequential limits. So if x sub n is a bounded sequence and we let this set S, which I'm going to denote with a capital S, to be the set of all little s's such that there exists a sub sequence x sub n sub k that converges to little s. Okay, this is called the set of sub sequential limits. Okay, so it's all of the things that your subsequences can converge to. Now remember that if your sequence xn is convergent, then there is one and only one element of this set. However, if x does not converge, then you can have subsequential limits that aren't equal to each other, right? And that's one of the ways we show that a sequence diverges. Okay, then, and here's the key, the lim sup of x sub n is actually the supremum, or the least upper bound, of this set. It's where it gets its primary name. This is the supremum of all subsequential limits. It's above or bigger than every subsequential limit, and it's also the least of all upper bounds for those. And limit inferiors are the infimum of the set. So another way of thinking of a lim sup is it is a least upper bound. It's the biggest that any subsequence can converge to. And that's all I really wanted to say about the lim inf and the lim sup. This definition that they give in the text is much more confusing than to think of it back in terms of these two sets right here, the m's and the n's, those two sequences, and just taking the supremum of the tail end of a sequence, or a progressively shorter tail. I shouldn't say shorter, but that's the idea. All right, and that's all I wanted to show you. So that's a better way to think about lim sups and lim ints.